It's a squeamish subject, but we all need blood, and a lot of it. In fact, every 3 seconds, someone in the US needs it, whether it's for having a baby, undergoing surgery, treatments for cancer, or chronic medical conditions like anemia. Blood saves millions of lives annually. But the catch is, we can only get it from each other, which is why very altruistic people in the world donate blood. Some 6.8 million people in the US alone donate every year. But where does all this blood go after it leaves your body? Does it go to the patient down the street? How about another city? Well, let's start at the post-donation stage. First, test tubes of your blood get sent to a lab to identify any infectious diseases and blood type. At the same time, your pint of blood, or unit as it's called, goes into a giant spinning centrifuge where it's separated into three different components: red blood cells, platelets, plasma. And each of these has a designated function. Red blood cells are what gives your blood its color and contain a protein called hemoglobin, which help it transport oxygen and carbon dioxide to and from your lungs. This is what's given to patients undergoing surgery or those with low blood cell count, like anemia. Platelets are fragments of other cells, and they help your blood coagulate properly. They're commonly used for cancer patients whose platelets have been affected from chemotherapy. And finally, plasma, a yellowish liquid that's a mixture of water, salt, and enzymes, but also antibodies, clotting factors, and proteins. While plasma's primary function is to be the literal liquid that shuffles cells throughout your body, it can be broken down one step further. The proteins and antibodies can be extracted and concentrated into therapies for rare chronic conditions. The next step is storing all of this collected good stuff. Each of these components are actually stored for different amounts of time in varying temperatures. Platelets can last up to 3 days, red blood cells last up to 42 days, and plasma can last up to a year frozen. So platelets and red blood cells are usually used within the country they were collected from. But plasma, since it can be stored for so long and is in such high demand globally, is the one that gets shipped overseas. If someone from the US donated today, their plasma could be sent to places like Australia, Canada, Belgium, and the Netherlands. It's something we don't think about, but plasma is a huge global market, and the US is one of the major exporters. And that's because they're one of the only countries to pay donors specifically for their plasma. According to data from the US Census Bureau, plasma, vaccines, and blood exports in 2017 were valued at about $20 billion. Dr. Robert Slonim, a global economist at the University of Sydney, estimates that 80% of the world market is receiving plasma from someplace outside its country of origin.
For many countries, for a very long time, has not been able to collect enough plasma for its needs. The U.S. has a paid system, and it's through private blood banks. It's basically the world supplier of plasma. As an example, in Australia, about 50% of all plasma products that are provided by the hospitals that enter the market here are coming from paid donors from the U.S.
There's a monetary incentive for plasma donations because it's a lengthy process and can be pretty uncomfortable.
So you can donate plasma much more regularly, but it's a much more involved process. The needle in typically is sort of in the 40, 45 minutes. What they'll do is the needle goes in, they extract your whole blood, they then put it through a centrifuge process, and they're separating out the red cells and the platelets from the plasma, and they keep the plasma, they put everything back into you. The very few countries that seem to be self-sufficient in plasma, the only way they've done it is by having these private blood banks that collect plasma.
But this is where things get sticky. Giving a paid incentive like that is controversial. The demand for blood and plasma is so high that economists argue it can't be sustained with just selfless virtue. But the World Health Organization finds the ethics of paid donations complicated, and there have been concerns with people lying about their health in order to get paid. Based on his research in the field, though, Dr. Slonim believes in giving a payment that's not directly cash, like a t-shirt or a gift card, and they've seen positive increases.
If you offer some form of compensation, what happens? In Italy, they offered you a paid day's leave if you were a blood donor. This program ran for 2 years, and they found a 40% increase in the blood supply in these communities that were offering this paid day's leave, which was really pretty powerful.
Right now, with the need for blood so high, tapping into our natural altruism might be the best method. So now that you know what happens to your blood after donating, are you more inclined to do so? Freaked out? Tell us in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.